So thank you for chatting with us for this video, Philipp. And could you just tell me a bit about yourself, the field you're in, and how long you've been using containers?
So I've been working for about 10 years in plant bioinformatics, plant computational biology, plant breeding, using a lot of HPC, of course, to analyze these large genomes. And then we're now getting into the sample sizes of, I don't know, 10,000, 20,000 individuals. And we're using containers, firstly, for more reproducible research. So we have everything nicely stored in one container so we can the next student can easily run the same pipeline, and also for setting up pipelines easier without having to rely on weird global Python or Perl setups that break immediately.
Okay. And what specifically is your role then at UWA?
I've just started a DECRA fellowship. So I've got my first PhD student, I supervise, and I'm also doing my own research in genomics.
Okay. And so you've got quite a depth and breadth of experience.
I guess.
Now, take me back to when you first started using containers. And what problems were you facing that you thought containers might be able to be the answer to or be able to help with?
Yeah, okay. So one problem is, of course, version dependencies. Especially bioinformatics software can be weird because you often have pipelines that consist of a bunch of tools. Each tool depends on a specific Python version or a specific Perl version, and then each of these Pythons or Perls depend on specific package versions, and everything breaks. So that's why we use containers in the first place, because then you just have everything. This container has exactly the right packages and exactly the right Python or whatever version, and it just works. And we don't have to spend like 2 weeks trying to set it up manually.
So really, there's a double complexity in there, right? You're talking about this software needs that software, which needs that software.
Yeah.
So there's that software dependency, but within that, you also have the version dependencies.
So the house of cards.
Oh, yes, house of cards for sure. So, I mean, that sounds tricky enough, right? So what was the hardest or trickiest bit, do you think, to overcome when you first started using containers?
From what I've seen, they do expect you to know a little bit how Linux works under the hood. So if you're a Linux beginner and you start using containers, you might have problems with the terminology of all the help materials, right? Like the Docker or Singularity text often immediately talks about here's your mount point and here's your root directory, whatever. And if you come from a beginner's background, you don't know what's going on and it doesn't help you much. So that, I think especially using it with students here, that's the biggest pain point right now. They do expect you to know a bit of what's going on under the hood.
Okay. So you would recommend first doing a bit of Linux and Unix upskilling on yourself or take a course or something. And is it pretty basic, the commands and the things that you need to know?
Yeah. I think it's more terminology, so you understand what they want from you.
Okay. And you did you start with Docker or did you start with Singularity?
A long time ago I used some Docker, but nowadays it's all Singularity, yeah.
Okay. And why? What would you recommend a new person start with once they get over that Linux, Unix?
If you're using HPC, I would use Singularity, of course, because most HPC systems don't support Docker because you have to be super user or root, so you don't have the rights as a regular user. Singularity also has these amazing overlay file systems, which I use now a lot. And as far as I know, Docker doesn't have these yet.
Okay. And what would be the one or two key pointers that you would give to someone who's considering using containers, but they're not quite sure if they should use them or they shouldn't use them. So what's that decision? What flips you into a yes or no?
Take a package you have to use for your work anyway that looks annoyingly complex to set up and just get a container and play around with it for a day. See whether that breaks or not. You can't break anything anyway, because that's the nice thing about containers, right? They're all immutable by default, so you can't delete stuff.
And so do you have to build your own all the time?
Not normally, no. Normally we use pre-built images by the package maintainers.
Okay. Can you walk me through an example of like a pretty basic example of a workflow and where you would put a container in it?
So we do a lot of whole genome assembly of various plants, and my favorite pipeline right now for calling transposable elements in whole genome assemblies is called EDTA. And again, like I said earlier, this is one of these typical bioinformatics pipelines, 5 packages under the hood, and they're all Perl and Python dependencies. So that's where I then use singularity immediately. I get my new genome assembly, and then I pull down the newest version of the container. I make a new overlay file system for all of my results, which takes like 5 minutes. And then I start running the analysis. It takes, I don't know, 20 minutes total.
Okay.
And then like 2 days later, I have my transposable elements.
Okay. And you talk about overlay file system. Tell me about that.
Oh, it's a neat system feature that Singularity has. So one problem you get with high performance computing is you're not allowed to have unlimited files on the file system because other users use the file system too, and everybody has like 5 billion files, the whole thing starts to crawl. Overlay file systems are kind of a workaround for that. What happens is Singularity, you make a single file, which is like, I don't know, 60 gigabyte size or whatever, and then Singularity makes another file system inside that file. So to the main computer, it's just a single file, and you don't really attack your own file quota much, but inside this single file, you can have, I don't know, 700 billion files or whatever. And a lot of these bioinformatics pipelines are that way, that they make many temporary files on the hard drive. So with EDTA, I mentioned earlier, I've many times hit the file limit. So wow. And then that solves it. So it's all in the overlay file system inside a container. And yeah, the nice side effect is that I can just take this whole container and smash it onto storage. And then next time I need to look up my results or some temporary intermediate step, I can just pull down the container, the overlay file system, and check what's in there. And I lose nothing.
Right. Okay. Thank you. Any final words of wisdom that you would like to share wisdom in your in your years? So how many years have you been using it?
Containers? Singularity? Maybe a year or two, I would say.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. So your ramp up was pretty painless, pretty painful?
Yeah, because I have easy workflows right now. You know, I just pull down these pre-built packages and run the commands. I don't make my own packages or whatever.
Okay. Okay. So, final word of wisdom.
I don't know, just try it out, play around with it. You can't break anything.
Perfect. Thanks very much for your time.
No worries.